This is Ham Radio Now, episode 207, part 2, continuing on with the TAPR Forum at the 2015 Dayton Hamvention. And coming up in this segment, Brian Fields, W9CR, on high-speed IP radio. Chris Testa, KD2BMH, update on the Whitebox. And Michael Ossmann, 80NR. And spectrum monitoring using software-defined radio. So that's what's up in this segment. One last pitch. Arvin would like you to know that we need your help. Stop by hamradionow.tv. Click on Arvin's icon if you want to help out, if you enjoy the programs and keep us on the air-ish, you know, internet and stuff, on YouTube, paying for all this television stuff. I put a camera in a new spot. I'd like to move them around once in a while. I got one over there, and so there's this one over here, and there's the one behind me, and the main camera. So, I'm just wasting your money. Don't send anything. What, Arvin? It's not a waste. I need them for the DCC. Okay. It's not a waste. I need them for the DCC. HamRadioNow.tv. Get me out of here. Back to Dayton.
Okay. Up next, we have... Brian Fields, who's going to talk to us about high-speed IP radio.
I'm live. Wow, there's a lot of people in here. My God, didn't realize this till I got up. Anyways, I'm Brian Fields, W9CR. It's a newer call for me in the last couple of years. So just getting some stuff set up there. I don't have a demo, but I have some props, and props are always a good thing to have. I'm originally from Southside Chicago, Northwest Indiana area. Live down in Florida right now. Have no plans to go back. I actually had to bring my winter jacket up here. I thought it was going to be cold and rainy all the weekend. Well, hopefully it won't rain. My background is really in carrier IP networks, microwave design, and I do a lot of stuff with IETF. It's the Internet Engineering Task Force. Really have been in all aspects of carrier IP networks since I got started in networking back in about 1999. Currently right now, I'm a senior consulting engineer in the transport division at Alcatel-Lucent, or Nokia. If you know about that, it's really funny. I'm also on, let me ask this. Anybody know what AmperNet is?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's the first time I've actually seen hands go up when I give this presentation. I'm a technical advisory committee member, which means I have no real authority to do anything, and we get together and do planning once in a while. So what I'm talking about here is similar to what they did, and I'll differentiate that in a little bit, but it's basically IP networking, basis of the internet. What I'm proposing with HamWAN is essentially the same thing as running your own internet. It is running your own internet. And anything that runs currently over the internet can work with this technology. It's IP, IP end-to-end, web browsers, Skype, whatever works across it. Currently though, every device needs a unique IP address. Just so happens that ham radio has this wonderful resource in ARDC, which is an amateur radio digital communications. It's a nonprofit, in an entire /8, or about 16 million IP addresses. And that's very critical right now, because IP addresses are scarce and expensive. We actually own them outright as ARDC, which is fairly amazing. ARDC and AmperNet are the same thing. So, we have to have that, and we have to have a way so that all networks can know about this. We deal with that with different routing protocols to tell us where different IPs live on the network. And this is actually different than the broadband hamnet, or what they just presented. That's more of a itinerant type solution. You bring a whole bunch of nodes in, you set it up, they all link up, and you can pass a little bit of data across them. You start getting into the inefficiencies when you have multiple nodes connected to multiple nodes and so forth and repeating. This is a fixed architecture, meaning that it's put into place. You set it up like you'd set up a, you know, repeater station or a fixed packet node or something. It's not a strictly emergency communications thing. It works during non-emergency times as well. It's very ideal actually for using the broadband hamnet to hang off of one of these nodes to get kind of access into broadband hamnet and bridge gaps that are in their coverage area. So some of the practical applications. I'm going to have an asterisk here, and I won't get too far into this because normally when I give this presentation, it's about an hour long. But essentially, we can do general internet access. We can do all these repeater linking applications that are out there. If you know about the All-Star Link or IRLP or even Echo Link, I have an All-Star node. I think most people are going to All-Star now over IRLP. It happens to be open source versus controlled and proprietary, and I really like stuff that's open source. The NXDN P25, it's all multicast IP, which is really ideal for this. The WebSDR, we have interfaces to this where you can hang one of these off of a wireless node and give it access and even use it as a remote monitoring station if you want. These are just an idea of some of the applications you can use. You can use anything literally that runs over the internet over this, because it is the internet. These guys are actually cool, this PhotoCam webcam. This is in the European HamWAN. These guys have about 4,000 nodes, and they're actually doing backhaul for high-resolution digital cameras. This is I don't know what city this is, somewhere in Poland, and it's under the clouds. It's very, very cool. Here's what some other people are doing around here. This is the HamWAN group out of Seattle. I don't know if you've heard of them. There's two major groups here. Some stuff I'm doing down in Tampa, St. Petersburg, HamWAN, Seattle, and also Memphis HamWAN. And I have Brian Turner, K0RET, from them. They have a banner over at the TAPR booth. We're going to be doing some questions and answers over there if you want to come by and pick our brains. And the other guys are the European Hamnet, and they have a website, HamnetDB. They have about 4,000 users. Can you imagine that? 4,000 users on the microwave bands that are licensed amateur radio operators spread across Europe. It is amazing. Currently, right now, they're in the process of getting their own gateway. Right now, all their stuff that goes to the internet gets tunneled all the way back to the US. It's a fairly inelegant way of doing it. This is their deployment. And this is, with the exception of the UK, pretty much everywhere in Central Europe has it. The gentlemen that have deployed it are based out of Germany, so they're pretty well represented. France, not so much. So, I guess the question I always get asked is, why do we need this? And the reason why we need this is, we need a backup of our commercial internet services. It doesn't do us any good if we can say we have a linked repeater network, and the second your cable modem goes out, all the links go down. That's unacceptable for ham radio. And simply doing conventional repeater linking with simplex radios and things like that, it does not scale. IP is proven to scale. And the only evidence for that is every single provider, whether it's a public service agency or somebody selling something to them, has chosen IP as their transport. Everything is going that way, if not already there. So we're slightly behind on this. Problem is, most of our microwave bands, they're shared with Part 15. And as the broadband mesh guys alluded to, as soon as everybody comes in on 2.4 gig, it's not going to work. This uses some of our other microwave bands that are close to Part 15, but don't overlap with Part 15 users. Not to say that there isn't a good use of Part 15 bands or the ham bands that overlap with that. We certainly have some good use there. It's just during any sort of an emergency, all these itinerant things come together and you can have real interference problems. I've had that as of last week even. So, anyways, the problem is these Part 15 operators, as I say, they have trashed the bands. And I want to point out a couple things here. They're really looking right now saying, hey, these hams have space. They have a lot of microwave bands. They're not doing anything with them. We should take them. There's a couple things. We have one exclusive 50 megahertz slice of band, 5850 to 5925. I know that's 75, but it's only exclusive to truly 50. That's designated as unlicensed national something infrastructure. It's called a uni band. Four. It's been designated that internationally. The FCC has not done anything about that. It's still exclusive to us in terms of ham radio, but they've got their eye on it. 10 gigahertz, the 10 gigahertz band. Mimosa Networks has a petition out right now with the FCC to take away all but 20 megahertz of it and give it over to wireless ISPs with an EIRP of 55 dBW. That's 85 dBm EIRP. I did the math there, 316 kilowatts EIRP. How's that gonna work? I commented on that, and what's ironic is some of the people that commented in proposing, you know, in favor of it, have actually been fined by the FCC before for violations. And the one band I really like, which is 3.3 to 3.5, 9 centimeter band, that's next. There's a couple small allocations, but it still doesn't overlap with us. However, the UK hams have lost, I think, all but about 5 megahertz of that in the 23 centimeter band. So we need more activity there. Say, hey, there's people using it. I'm not gonna go into all the legal issues. I am gonna say, as you all are aware, Part 97 puts a number of restrictions on what you can do and can't do with the, you know, bands and what kind of traffic you have. I think legally right now, if you have a station set up repeating, you're responsible for every single packet that goes across there. I'm not worried about that too much. I think it's better to build something and work with a potential violation that might crop up when the FCC comes calling than it is to not do it and say, well, it's a rule, I can't do anything about it. I'd rather make a good faith effort to comply with the rules and, you know, deal with what may happen. The FCC is fairly easy to work with in that regard. The big thing is, as far as I read the rules, you can't do encryption, which I think we all probably aware of. There's a couple of different problems this presents because you have encryption of internet traffic, you have encryption of the links. Definitely encryption of the links isn't there, but some traffic may go across that's encrypted. I'm not really filtering that. I don't know if you should or not. That's for you guys to decide. How do you actually identify your links? Well, easy. You can set one side of the link if you're, you know, owning it on both sides to your call sign, the SSID. It's a service set identifier. The other thing you can do is pings, things like that. The Hamwan guys out of Seattle, hamwan.org, they have a number of standards available for that. The big thing on this is only licensed amateur radio operators are part of this. I don't want to do something where it's allowing everybody general internet access. No, it has to be for hams only because we're using amateur radio only frequencies. So in terms of the equipment that we have, and I have some of the equipment up here, I'll go through that at the end. We have really two major vendors of product that we can buy from that are in our price range as hams. One is MikroTik, and the other one's Ubiquiti. MikroTik's kind of cool. It's a Linux-based thing. They're based out of Latvia. Say what you will about software-based routers. I think they're horrible, but I work for a major router vendor, so they work really well for ham applications. You know, we're not trying to do gigabits of traffic here, or in my case, you know, terabits of traffic. Ubiquiti, they kind of have their own two different OSs. One's better than the other. They're not particularly ham-friendly right now. They've actually gone through and shut down a lot of their stuff to be able to make it go into the 5.9 gig band. However, they do have some cool stuff for 3 gig, so there's different ways to look at it. The other one is DB2. They make some little micro PCI cards. So you use a little radio card, put it into a Ubiquiti router, and now you have a ham radio. So this is typically what a deployment looks like at a base station. You have up here at the top, these are your sector antennas for access at 5.9, and then your backbone radios at 9 centimeters. And these are all high gain. We're using on the backbone here, we're using what's called MIMO, which uses both horizontal and vertical polarization simultaneously. It actually uses interference between them to to increase the amount of bandwidth that's available for data throughput. Won't get into the math behind that, but it's fascinating. This is typically what you have at a client site, and we have one of these here, right here. This is the antenna, same thing there, and what's called a microtik metal. So this is a 5.9 gigahertz radio, 29 dB antenna. You know, we're talking under $200. You put this at your house or a client site, connecting to one of the access points to one of the base stations. Typical install. This is actually Bart's old house from the Hamwan guys out in Seattle. As far as our microwave bands, we have essentially, this is our 5.9 gigahertz band right here. You can see here's our entire band, but it overlaps with 5.4, 5.8, and the ISM band. So we really only have this slight slice right here that we can use that's guaranteed to be interference-free. Should be interference-free. I've actually had some interference from operators putting their stuff there. That's easy to solve. The 3 gigahertz band, this is nice because we're not even anywhere near the commercial operators. There's a Part 90 licensed, which is now grandfathered, and there's a Part 96, which is, this is new as of 4.15. And this is the coverage of a Ubiquiti M3, and this is coverage of the DB Network's FN 36 Pro. And you can see we cover almost the top 125 megahertz of the band. So 3.4 to 3.5 gigahertz is entirely ours, and we can do it with as we please. Basically, microwave is line of sight. So, you know, there's some problems here. It'll modulate down. And what we like to do for providing reliable internet access and reliable access on our links is monitor our links so that we have a good deal of fade margin. So this means shorter links. We might be able to get a link that's 40 miles, but it's not going to be reliable, not because of rain, but because of fading and distortion that happens when we have rain. So there's a couple of free calculators out there. I think everybody has probably heard of Radio Mobile at this point. That is kind of okay for doing path loss. It uses a different modeling program. It's more of an area coverage tool. You can do it by hand if you want. It's pretty easy with microwave. There's another one that I like to use. I have it for work. It's called PathLoss 5.0. It's kind of the standard of microwave radio propagation. Problem is it's about $7,000. But if you want me to model a link, send it to me. I'll model it for you until I start doing everybody's links. So in terms of network architecture and backbone, we have a couple major parts of the network. We have access points, our backbone links, which I've showed are 9 centimeters, and then routers. We like to have our access sites co-located with, you know, conventional digital repeaters, things like that. That way we can easily hand off an IP link to them and now put the repeater on the air or do it in EOC or somewhere like that. And again, should be on battery backup. We run everything off of UPS 110 volts. It just makes it easier. So this is kind of what the network overview would look like. These are all your, you know, backbone sites all talking together. You can have clients hang off of these. And then this is what the site actually looks like inside. So here's your site. You have an east and a west radio. And these are the 3.4 gigahertz radios. And then you have some 5.9 gigahertz access points. I know it says microtik, and I got a picture of canopy up there, but it's the only thing I could find. So, and then you have your end users talking to the access points and using a different radio path to get the traffic away from the site. This allows you to have less contention and do higher actual bandwidth and start getting into things like quality of service, doing reliable voice over IP without having to worry about interference from other users. And then finally, and probably the most important thing that sets us apart, is we have a router down there. That router makes intelligent decisions based on where packets should go by running a routing protocol. So every single router on the network knows the condition of the network. And, you know, if this link right here fails, it automatically routes traffic onto the other link. And in most cases, you don't even know about it. You know, you see an alarm or something, but that's about it. So kind of already went through what routers are. Routing protocols, I'm not going to go into that. If you want to talk routing protocols with me, please do so. Yep, awesome. And The other problem we have had, and this is more of an issue for me down in Florida, is we don't have a lot of tall things to go on other than buildings. There's been a lot of consolidation of real estate, which means site acquisition, tower sites really aren't ideal because there's been a lot of consolidation in the tower industry. Has anybody had the misfortune of having a site get sold to American Tower or somebody like that? And hey, you hams, you can pay $2,500 and a $2,000 engineering study to put one antenna up there. That's not going to work for a nonprofit organization such as ours, because we like to do links and move stuff around fairly regularly. I like buildings. Most of the time you can find buildings, you can get on them, they're easy to work with, and if you're a nonprofit organization, 501c3, they can deduct the fair market value of what they're giving you off their taxes. Most people like that. You gotta have a legal document. Gotta have a legal document. You can't just go up somewhere on a handshake. We've literally lost equipment because of that, and we're dealing with equipment that we might have to put that's, you know, $1,000 at a site. I don't wanna lose that. So I need some interest in this. We have a couple groups in the area, or in the country, excuse me, doing this. I'd like to get more people doing it in their, you know, locations and wherever they wanna go, you know, wherever's home for you. You don't necessarily have to be a networking person, it helps. What I found is the people that are into this, that are networking people, are really into it. I'm really into it. What's kind of cool is we can interlink entire states. I would love to do something personally that interlinks something outside of Tampa Bay. You know, I'd love to go south, I'd love to go north. I mean, I have delusions of grandeur. The aspects of this from public service. We can do reliable multi-megabit data services. The problem with mesh, well, it's great for itinerant when everybody shows up and we have nothing existing. This we can deliver megabits of data across it reliably. I'm using this to bring younger people into ham radio because there's some high school networking classes where they actually teach kids some of the Cisco certifications, but they're interested. And this is more like service provider networking, so it's not something they have access to. A couple of our groups, and this is going to be available, I think, on website download from TAPR. And feel free to use my slides too if you want to, if you need to present this. They're all licensed GNU free document license. My group that I started, we're 501c3, Memphis HamLAN, and we have Ryan from there. He's going to be at the booth today. Come by, talk to us. We'll have a banner up. 44Net. These little guys will get you IP addresses. We have an email list set up for that. There's a procedure for that. If you have any questions, give me a call. Give me an email. I'll try and help you in between travel for work and everything else. And then most importantly is HamWAN. These guys have really set the bar and set standards. We also have HamLAN and 44Net on Freenode IRC. I'm Dark Helmet on there. Come by, say hi. It's a nick. That's how IRC is. And that's basically my presentation. I got a couple things I was going to show here. This is what one of the typical sector antennas looks like. So this would go out and talk to your client customers, which have these things on their house or other site. These are very small. They're unobtrusive, so they're not like putting up a huge DB420 repeater antenna or something like that. And they're cheap too. These are a couple hundred dollars.
Which band is that on?
That is a 5 gigahertz. That's a dual polarity 5 gigahertz antenna. We try to stay out of 2.4 because the ham band overlaps 100% with the ISM band, and I was just at a conference for work at McCormick Place last week. The guys brought in wire. Our corporate people didn't want wires at our booth, so everybody had a wireless mouse and keyboard to work the demos. I made an emergency, I counted over 350 access points just on my phone in 2.4. It didn't work at all. I had to run to Micro Center and an Uber back and forth, the $150 cab ride, to go pick up wired keyboards. So that's why I want to stay out of that. I think we have a lot of bands that don't overlap, and for this infrastructure-based stuff where we have some time and can plan it out, we can do some amazing things there. So come by the booth, talk to me, send me an email. I really want to get some people interested in this. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, I'm 5 minutes early too.
He's early. You guys are making it easy for me. Okay, up next, we have Chris, KD2BMH. He's going to talk to us about the Whitebox project. And you probably heard that before here. You're going to hear more today.
So I'm going to talk about the Whitebox project, but first I want to talk a little bit about an experience that I had over the past couple of months dealing with John Stevenson's KD60ZH. He passed away sometime last year. We learned about it at the DCC, last year's DCC, and he lived in Fresno. It just so happens I live in Los Angeles, so I was close enough to meet with Tom Holmes, who's on the TAPR board, to check out what did John have, and because John gave us both a cash donation and donated all of his RF lab to TAPR, and all of his prototypes, all of his software, everything that he did. And yeah, which is awesome. And so what John was working on was, he was like all the talks before, he was working on high-speed backhaul links using microwave bands. And he had built this prototype. He built many prototypes. This is one called the DCP-14. And this one actually operates from, I think, 50 megahertz up to 2.2 gigahertz. He had another one that was a direct conversion software-defined radio that he built as well. His goal was to blanket the entire San Joaquin Valley with high-speed microwave. And he, towards the end of his life, was working on some of the last emails that we have of how he was, you know, using various tools to map out his RF links, and, you know, seeing what towers he would need to use and what power levels and what antennas. He built this device. It was a 100% standalone software-defined radio. It didn't require a computer to operate. It was very interesting for me because a lot of the things that I've been very interested in the Whitebox project, he had been working on for years before. And I've seen a bunch of John's papers over the years about high-speed links or high-speed protocols and his processor that he made. And I really respected a lot of his work and really enjoyed reading about it. And he, you know, gave me a lot of ideas. So I didn't realize when I first went to his house that this is whose house I was walking into. So he created this whole system based on a Xilinx Spartan 3 FPGA, field programmable gate array. He made a custom processor inside of it called the CPU-16F. And we just wrote an article about this, Scotty and I. It's in this most recent QEX. And we go into much more detail about what he did, not all the detail that it deserves. We're out there looking for people who were working with John and, you know, knew of his work, knew what he was working on, because it's really just a sea of stuff. He wrote everything. He made custom Verilog modules for OFDM modems and turbo coding, and wrote his own assembler in Delphi, and there's so many pieces to what he did. And we need help. We need people who want to collaborate on this. There's some great RF equipment. There's some great prototypes to work with. We have some ideas of where we would like to take it. There's been some proposals, but we need more, and we need more people to get involved. So please talk to Scotty or myself, or really anyone at TAPR, about John's work if you're interested. Any questions about that before I move on? Okay, so I'm Chris Testa, KD2BMH. I'm gonna talk to you about the third prototype of my project that I'm working on called the Whitebox. So a little background, I studied computer engineering at the University of Maryland. I graduated in 2007. After graduating, I moved to Los Angeles. I worked at Google and I worked at YouTube. I got to do a lot of interesting things with large distributed systems, or now is more commonly called cloud computing. I'm an Eagle Scout and I love to go backpacking. So my like technology interest with my love of being out in nature, when I had my first smartphone, I was wondering, why doesn't my smartphone work when I'm in the backcountry? I need something that will work when I'm in the backcountry. And that led me to find amateur radio, and ultimately led me to find TAPR. TAPR is the organization that if you're interested in software-defined radio, these are the people who know what's going on. These are the people who are actually building software-defined radios that can help you, they can teach you, they can connect you with people. Awesome. So I believe in a free and open internet. I think many people in here, more this year, just to start, I think this is a taste. There's more talk about internet on ham stuff than ever before. And I know that it's a little contentious. There's a lot of debates about encryption and, you know, who's using it for what. And it, you know, it goes back to the, I think, to the, can I call up a pizza order using, you know, an auto patch? And I think we have a lot of interesting things that we're going to discuss and figure out in the future about how we're going to use ham and the internet together in some new kind of new fashion. And I don't know exactly what that looks like yet. So in 2013, I started working on this project that I call the Whitebox in order to figure out what we could do. So last year I came up here and I talked about the Bravo project, and which is the second version of my board. Since then, the biggest thing that I have now is I actually have real RF test equipment, which before I was kind of shooting blind, just dialing around on my transceiver to see if what I was doing was working. Now I have things that will tell me where are my spurs, what's my minimum discernible signal, just the important things that you need to know if you're going to really build and operate a legal, powerful transceiver. I turned on the receiver right after Hamvention last year. I gave the 4-hour lecture at the DCC this past September on building system on a chip field programmable gate arrays, and Gary has all of that up on Ham Radio Now, so you can watch those 4-hour lectures in all of its glory detail and learn about how these very small chips work and operate and how you can actually kind of build your own using the latest tech. Since then, after that, I moved my project to using something called the Smart Fusion FPGA. Now I'm using something called the Smart Fusion 2. This is the more modern one. It's more powerful. It has a whole bunch of new peripherals. It's just better in every category kind of thing. One big thing that it has is it has USB on the go, so you can do all sorts of fun stuff, connecting anything up to it or connect it to the computer. It can look like a sound card. It could be a sound card. You can plug in a sound card, Wi-Fi, et cetera, et cetera. And then really this year, I've been really focused on building the new version of the board. So this is the new one in a case. This year I finally have a case for it, where previously it was really for my bench. This is more shots of, I'm gonna show bigger ones of this, but this is the top and the bottom of the board. This design is 5 times more complicated in the sense that there's 5 times as many parts as on the last one, but it actually has amplifiers, it has better power. I'm gonna go over it. There's a lot of features. So the idea is that for now you're gonna use your smartphone as the interface to the radio, either over Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. It also has an Ethernet jack on it. We'll make more expensive versions that have touch screens built into them, but that's not really worth doing immediately. It's more important to get the hardware out there. Because it runs a web server right on it, the manual is right on the device. So you don't have to have a manual anymore. You can just access it and you can change all the configuration and see what's going on right there. It has a little Linux computer built into it, which is pretty useful. And it's based on this Smart Fusion processor, which has what's called a flash-based gate array. And that has very low power dissipation versus other types of FPGAs. So it operates from 50 megahertz to 1,000 megahertz. It has two built-in IF filters, one for narrow band, 30 kilohertz, one for the widest bandwidth that the transceiver chip I'm using affords, which is 1.6 megahertz. It's designed to really meet FCC specifications for both transmit and receive. It can do AM, double sideband suppressed carrier, FM, single sideband, digital modes. I don't yet have an amplifier that you can juice up or down, like has a valve, but I would very much like one that you can overdrive into nonlinear mode or, you know, drive lower. It can operate full duplex, but it's really half duplex. But it right now, the transmit receive switch operates on the order of a Linux kernel Jiffy, which is like the fastest time step. But I can move that transmit receive switch inside of the FPGA, and then we can actually make it microsecond switches between the two. And the idea is that modulations are different apps. So I don't know if anyone's seen this, but FLDigi has been ported to Android, which is super cool. APRS Droid. So like your phone can really do everything at this point. There's potential for mesh networking, potential for fixed networking, repeater stuff. You hook up to it, you know, Ethernet, Wi-Fi, USB, can operate as both a USB master, USB slave. And I'm not gonna end up writing all the software. There's so many things, but I'm looking for, because it's gonna be open source, for the community to contribute different parts to it. So this is a high overview of the new design. How do I operate the, oh, there you go. Okay, so all of these dots are RF switch networks. So on the right-hand side, we have the FPGA, and on the other side is the antenna. So the FPGA, you know, uses USB on the go and Ethernet. There's a 10 megahertz clock reference, the ADC and DAC. There's a transceiver. Oh, there is some part of my picture that is not here, as you would expect when you use open source software and then convert it to a PowerPoint. There's a low noise amplifier, power amplifier. There's four band pass filters that you can switch in, and you can replace them for whichever bands you're interested in. And then another critical part is I have this RF log detector now that lets me calibrate the transmitter. And that's an important piece from last time. On the software side of things, at the very bottom, this is all just like looking at what's in the FPGA. There's a digital up converter and digital down converter, just like in any other software-defined radio. I have this modem in the system on a chip. There's Ethernet and USB on the go. Above that, there's an ARM Cortex M3 processor, direct memory access controller. And then the Linux, there's a Linux kernel 2.6.33. It's kind of like what's on your Ubiquiti router, or I don't actually know if it's on a Ubiquiti router, but it's a similar chip to what's used in many routers that you can reprogram different things on it. And then above that, what's new this year is I'm using libwebsockets to create this interface with the web browser. So one web browser interface works on iOS, Android, Windows, you know, Chrome, Firefox, you know, it all uses that, and you can use the web audio API, video APIs. There's a lot of possibilities with that. So this version is the third generation. It will not be miniaturized all the way. It's about this big, and you can come to the booth. I don't have it with me. We have it set up at the booth in Hara Arena. And it uses the smallest components I've ever used on a board, but it's still not small enough to be something like the size of an iPhone motherboard. And we really need to move to very specialized machinery in order to assemble devices that small. It's not that I can't conceive of them, it's that we need to really know that we're ready to make a lot of them if we're gonna make something that totally fits in your pocket. But I think that this is still really interesting. It's got a 100 milliwatt amplifier. It works, you can use it with down east microwave, single band 30 watt amplifier, so you can bump it up if you would like. And this board, as opposed to my previous boards, is ready to be used by people, you know, ready to be moved from my RF lab to the world and be shared with everyone. So this is more of a close-up. This was an early picture when we first got it back, but this is where the Smart Fusion module fits in. There's, you know, barrel power jack. I have monster capacitors on it now. Here's where the bandpass filter switching network is, low noise amplifier. That's where the transceiver chip is, which is not populated in the shot. Here's the power amplifier. There's lots of these little U.FL connectors, which are standard in Wi-Fi products, but I have them all over the board as test points, RF test points. Those probably won't be on a production run, but you know, as we start building them, these are very useful to see what's happening in the, in this mess. This is a 6-layer circuit board. The last one was a 4. 6-layer circuit board lets me use microstrip, which greatly simplifies kind of like underneath there's like this patch of all these cables to move things around, and so you can just kind of set it up much more cleanly. On the bottom, there's oscillators over here. There's, you know, the power supplies. There's a place to take in an external 10 megahertz reference, ADC and DAC, all those things. So what are the features? So it'll, the in terms of power, it will accept anything from 6 volts to 26 volts. And it's really designed to be plugged right into the fuse box under your car seat, right into the alternator. So that's something that I think is very useful to have. I have switching supplies for all the digital components. I have analog supplies with very high power supply rejection ratio, if that means anything to you. And everything on the board can be completely shut off except for the real-time clock. So it should have an extremely low power mode, which, you know, lines up with kind of my original vision, which was the, you know, a handheld transceiver. You need to be able to completely shut off the transceiver and turn it back on quickly. That's an important part of that. In codec land, codec is like the analog to digital converter and digital to analog converter stuff. That's all together called the codec. I have a new auxiliary codec that's looking at the input voltage, temperature, receive signal strength, looking at the PLLs and the RF log detector, and then I have an auxiliary digital analog converter, which is used for fine calibration on the transmitter. Clocking, there's a plug for external 10 megahertz reference, there's proper op amps. I kind of went all the way, I just put everything on the board instead of you know, just trying to put the little pieces in each one and trying to make it work together. I just followed best engineering practice and just put everything on there. So this design is a little bit more expensive than my previous ones, but it has all of the parts there to give it very strong amplification, proper filtering at each stage throughout the, you know, the receive and transmit chain, et cetera. I stole the Raspberry Pi B+ expansion header pinout, so it should be possible to plug in Raspberry Pi like expansion boards. I have ESD protection inputs and a nice open drain output for push to talk, so you can control that big amplifier. And the Smart Fusion 2 adds hardware multipliers onto the FPGA. It adds USB on the go. Lots of cool features there to play with. I haven't even turned all of them on. There's something called the RF gateway, and this is something that I learned from Bruce Perrins that needs to be in a legal transceiver. You have to block certain old cellular service bands in the 800 megahertz frequency from reception in order to sell an FCC legal device. So this gateway prevents you from locking the PLL on those frequencies. There's an optional single-ended. Oh, there's RF debug ports everywhere. And then transmitter calibration. Let's see. So the onboard amplification goes up to 100 milliwatts. There's 4 bandpass filters, mentioned that. Noise source, receiver LNA. Okay, so here we go. So navigating the intellectual property world is very difficult. There's not many FCC legal open source software defined radio platforms. In fact, I don't know of any of them. So making software is cheap. Costs like $1,000 for a laptop and you're off making software. Making RF hardware is a little more expensive. You need to build prototypes. You need to have a real RF test bench. It's not cheap to make this stuff. And I've decided, Bruce Perrins has been extremely helpful this past year helping me get the RF test equipment, that we're actually partnering, and should the Whitebox come out to the real world, it'll be in partnership with him as a company called Algorand. So the problem is that software is copyrightable, so I can enforce an open source license. And I can copyright my schematic and my layout, and I can enforce that you can't, an open source license on those, but I can't copyright physical hardware. So in order to enforce an open hardware license, you actually have to have a patent. And this is something that I've learned from the TAPR community. And so I've always considered me making circuit boards, like, this is my art. This is not, like, when I see those, images, that's art to me. That's what I've been working on. It's not some, manufacturing process description. So, we have a whole thing to deal with there, but I'm not interested in going down that route. So what we're going to do is we're going to have almost everything is going to be open source except for that RF gateway. Even that will be open source. We'll probably just make it not possible for you to reprogram it. But all the schematics will be available, and there'll be a detailed service manual describing what all the parts are, their tolerances, replacements, all those sorts of things. And what we're going to do is we're going for a dual license strategy. So if you're an amateur radio operator tinkering, you have a license to do whatever you want with this. But if you're going to try to sell FCC type certified equipment to, the LMR business, we're going to look for a license. So that's the way we're going to try. That's the big experiment. I don't know that this has been really done before in hardware, but this is what we're going to go for. So the first three Charlie boards, I had them built just the other week. And the goal is to release boards out to the world before the end of this year. We'll start with small runs as we mature the hardware. But I really do plan on getting hardware out this year to people to play with. And I'm looking for collaborators in hardware world, in firmware world, in embedded system land, in Android app development. There's so many things to do. And this is really a call for people to get interested. So that's our first kind of shot of what Algorand is. And we're in Hara Arena, booth HA75, of course, right across from the D-Star booth. So come check us out. That was not planned. That just is how it happened. So that's it. Thanks.
All right. Thanks, Chris. So I guess we got Mike up next.
Okay. Hey, thanks for coming, everybody. I'm Michael Ossmann of Great Scott Gadgets. And as of 60 days ago, I'm AD0NR. Thank you. So this is my first amateur radio event since I'm actually an amateur radio operator. I want to talk today about spectrum monitoring with software-defined radio. And I think a lot of people who have started using software-defined radio have found themselves looking at screens like this, where you get a waterfall plot of some sort, and it's updated in real time, and it's pretty exciting the first time you see something like this, especially if you've never worked with digital radio systems before. In this example, a HackRF is being used to monitor 20 megahertz of bandwidth, looking at, I think this is a GSM bands in Europe, and I downloaded this video off of YouTube. I just searched for somebody who was doing a waterfall plot with HackRF, and this is one of the ones that I found. And so you're looking at 20 megahertz of bandwidth, and it's getting updated in real time, and you're seeing so many things all at once, so much more than perhaps you've ever seen before. And so it can be kind of exciting at first, and you can think that you're seeing everything that's going on, and you almost are. But if you think about it, and also here's another example of just a similar kind of waterfall plot shown on an Android tablet that's powering HackRF and using it. But if you look at that display down here, and you think about how much information is getting displayed, well, the HackRF, if it's giving you 20 megahertz of bandwidth, it's actually giving you 40 megabytes per second of data, 40 million bytes every second coming over the USB interface. That's how much information about the radio spectrum it's giving you all at once. How many of those bytes make it on to the waveform view or here, or into the waterfall plot here? Maybe you're seeing, you know, several rows of pixels per second. You know, you may be looking at only a thousandth or less than a thousandth of the information that the software-defined radio device is giving you. So it seems like you're seeing a lot. You're getting the opportunity to see many different bands simultaneously, if you're dealing with narrowband signals. But there are actually some limitations here that maybe you haven't thought about. Now, these limitations or problems, I think of three different limitations of these waterfall plots. And one is that in most waterfall plots, you're missing transient events. A row of pixels is displayed on the screen. Then time goes by. Then a row of pixels is placed on the screen. Then time goes by. What's the duty cycle? How much time is represented in that row of pixels versus how much time was represented between each row of pixels? Well, usually it's something like 1 out of 1,000. And you're just missing very brief transient events. And this becomes very significant if you're working with digital technologies, packet-based technologies, things that have packets that last very short periods of time, like Bluetooth packets, for example. The shortest Bluetooth packets are around 200 microseconds long. And actually, most Bluetooth packets are, you know, a few hundred microseconds long. It's easy for those things to be completely missed. All kinds of short digital packets all over the spectrum are completely missed by most of the waterfall plots that we see day to day. Other things, other limitations of waterfall plots. One is that limited time is displayed. Usually you're only seeing a few seconds on your screen at a time. Sometimes it might be nice to log data for a long period of time. Wouldn't it be cool to be able to look at an hour's worth of data at a time, or a day or a month? And another thing is that the only limited bandwidth is displayed. It might seem like a lot of bandwidth at first, but HackRF, for example, can tune from 1 megahertz to 6 gigahertz. 6 gigahertz of operating frequency range, and we're only looking at a few megahertz at a time in our waterfall plot. Well, wouldn't it be cool to actually look over multiple gigahertz? I think that would be really cool. But before we get to that, let's talk about the first problem. Missing transient events. This is actually more of a problem of the software. The hardware is giving you a complete description of everything that is going on in that bandwidth in real time, but the software generally doesn't display it. Well, there's at least one piece of software that can do that, or at least come close, and that is GR Phosphor, or just Phosphor. And this is using the GPU, or it can use your CPU, in your PC in order to accelerate the process of doing the FFTs, the calculation that needs to be done in order to convert the waveform data coming from the SDR device into the waterfall plot or the spectrogram. And here's a little video. This is something I just found online. Right now it's showing the FM broadcast band, the whole FM broadcast band. You're seeing every single FM radio station, now the user is tuning around to some different frequencies. But you'll notice that this spectrogram, or the waterfall plot, is much faster than most that I've ever seen and probably that you've ever seen. And in addition, there is a very colorful spectrum plot above it that is able to indicate peaks that happen very, very briefly. Things that would be too fast for your eye to catch actually do get represented with some kind of a decay up in that upper part of the display. This is super cool. And if you've ever seen a real-time spectrum analyzer, here we are back in the FM broadcast band, you can see all of those FM modulations wiggling back and forth in time. If you've ever looked at a real-time spectrum analyzer, not a traditional spectrum analyzer, not a swept analyzer, but a real-time spectrum analyzer, these things cost tens of thousands of dollars, they have displays that look like that. And essentially what they are high-end software-defined radios, software-defined radio receivers, with some good software. And we can build the same thing with any software-defined radio receiver, as long as we have the software to do it. So to me, phosphor solves that first problem. And there are other solutions to that problem too, the most obvious being that you can just save waveforms to disk and from your software-defined radio receiver, and then view them or post-process them. You can explore what happened later. So we have a couple of different ways to kind of solve that problem. But we still have these other two problems. The waterfall display only shows a limited period of time, and it only shows a limited amount of bandwidth compared to the operating frequency range of the software-defined radio receivers. Now, traditionally, the way that you would kind of look at much more bandwidth would be to use a spectrum analyzer. And I was kind of comparing to HackRF, for example. HackRF goes up to 6 gigahertz. So I looked around online to see what's the least expensive commercial benchtop spectrum analyzer that I could find new. And it was this one for $8,000. I think it would be cool to use, you know, a device for a few hundred dollars instead of using a device that costs a few thousand dollars if you can. And spectrum analyzers, most of them are swept. And so the old school analog spectrum analyzers, of course, sweep their frequency over time in a smooth curve. If you plot the frequency that it's actually tuned to over time, you get something like this. And you can see that there are gaps in between all these, you know, it's only tuned to one frequency at a time. And so, again, this has the possibility of missing transient events. And there really isn't any way to solve that I know of other than doing wideband capture, with a SDR or a real-time spectrum analyzer. But we can also sweep digitally. And when you sweep digitally, you sweep the frequency in steps. And you capture a little bit of information about one frequency and then advance to a different frequency and capture a little bit of information about that. And theoretically, you can do just as good a job for most functions doing digital sweeping as you could with analog sweeping. And you see this in digital spectrum analyzers. You see this kind of technique in very low cost digital spectrum analyzers. Sometimes you get a handheld tool or maybe a USB tool for monitoring Wi-Fi or whatever. This is an example. I wrote firmware for the IME. It's so cool and so connected. And it's a toy that's designed for it's designed for text messaging. And so it operates in a 900 megahertz band, and you can text message your friend who has one of these. It actually gets gatewayed through the internet. So it goes from the IME to a dongle on an internet-connected computer to another dongle on an internet-connected computer over the air to another IME. But you can reprogram these things. And I wrote firmware that steps or digitally sweeps, which is stepping through multiple frequencies. And each vertical column in the display is one frequency that it's tuned to. and it measures the signal strength and moves on. All it's doing is measuring signal strength. This is not software-defined radio, but it is an effective spectrum analyzer, and it's much faster than you might think it is. In fact, this thing is updating, I think, 25-ish screens per second times 132 frequencies, I think. That's how many times per second it's tuning. And I was having a problem trying to pick up a transient signal on a Tektronix MD-04000 spectrum analyzer. It was one of those nice scopes with a poor spectrum analyzer built in. And I was trying to, it really is a nice scope. I was trying to pick up a transient signal, and I couldn't. I kept missing it. And so I just pulled out my IME, and I got it, like, every time. And the reason I could is because my hopping time, or my tuning time, or my sweep time was highly optimized. It doesn't do much else. It doesn't have all the fancy functions, of course, that your benchtop spectrum analyzer does. But it does sweep pretty quickly. So let's do the same thing with software-defined radio. Let's take a software-defined radio receiver and sweep it or step it through different frequencies. So let me do just a real quick live demo with the with a Realtek dongle. I've talked a lot about the HackRF, but I also like the Realtek TV tuner dongles, right? Everybody should have one of these if you have any interest in SDR. Do you have $10 and a willingness to buy things from a sketchy dealer in China? If not, do you have $20? Thank you to Melissa for that joke. So let's just do a real quick demo here. All I'm going to do is just tune this through the FM broadcast band. It's a command line tool, and here's what it does. It steps through various frequencies and dumps the data out in text format. You can put this into a text file, you can plot it, and so forth. I'm not gonna do all that because we have limited time, but I just wanted you to get the feel for what's going on here. If you look at the center frequency, which is near the middle of the screen, you can see that center frequency is getting updated every time it tunes the radio and gets more data. And also you'll notice that there are multiple lines in a row all at the same center frequency. The reason for that is because we're getting several samples, I don't know, a few thousand samples or something like that, from the SDR receiver, and when we're tuned to a single frequency. And then we compute an FFT and learn about frequency information across a bandwidth around that center frequency before we move on to the next center frequency. And this is a good example of what we can do with software-defined radio. By stepping through multiple frequencies, we can save all this to disk, and I'll show you a little bit more of what we can do with it in a minute. Another tool you might be interested in is, and one reason that Osmocom Spectrum Sense is cool is because it's part of the GR Osmo SDR project, which is a project that supports many different software-defined radio peripherals, including the Realtek dongles, including HackRF, including others. So you can use the same software tool with a variety of different hardware platforms. Another tool, and this one unfortunately is specific to the Realtek dongle, but it's quite good, is called RTL Power. And it works in a very similar way. So here's an example of the output from RTL Power. Look familiar? It's not too different, you know, it's a slightly different format of formatting of data, but it's the same kind of idea where it's sweeping through a lot of different frequencies or stepping through a lot of frequencies and giving you some output. In this case, it's only really giving me one power reading per step, I think, but it's possible to configure it to give you several different frequency bins per hop or per step. So here's an example of the output of RTL Power, which I saved to a log file and then converted to an image from last night in my hotel room. This is run overnight for about 8 hours. And This is over 2 gigahertz of bandwidth. So I'm monitoring the usage of spectrum here. And let me zoom in. Okay, so this is some stuff around 900 megahertz, 1 gigahertz. Notice something happened about halfway through the night, like around 3 a.m. I put my cell phone into airplane mode and went to sleep. That's why things get a lot quieter. You can see like a bunch of little bursts in the 2 meter band and so forth. This wasn't the best looking thing. I was just using this Realtek dongle with a telescopic antenna. Ideally for this kind of wideband capture, you'd use a disc cone or some other kind of wideband antenna. And you wouldn't have your cell phone on within 1 meter of it and stuff like that. Let me show you a different one that I found on the internet. Here is a similar plot that somebody made that's a lot cleaner and is nicely labeled. So I can scroll around and see like decked phones. I think this was in Europe. Thank you, Tolan, from the RTL-SDR channel. Here's some GSM and LTE stuff. Here's 70 centimeter band, all those bursts on the right, and on the left, those bursts are 2 meter band. So you can monitor the usage of spectrum over as long a period of time as you want, and over as wide a bandwidth as your device supports. In the case of the Realtek dongles, the TV tuner dongles, that's usually around 2 gigahertz. In the case of HackRF, that's around 6 gigahertz. And of course, there are all kinds of other SDR peripherals out there that have varying capabilities. I think this is really cool stuff. I hope that at least one of these two things is something you'll try at home. Phosphor is awesome. RTL Power and Osmocom Spectrum Sense, super cool. I hope to try these things out. I haven't actually tried this one yet. Here's another screenshot that I just grabbed from online somewhere, because people are starting to write front-end software for RTL Power. And this is one called Q Spectrum Analyzer. And it's just a GUI front-end to help you operate RTL Power and see the results quickly, instead of having to go through and post-process data and view it separately. But I'm trying to make this even better. And you know, I mentioned earlier that the IME was very successful at picking up transient events. And the reason that it could is because its tuning time was very short and its overall sweep time was pretty short. And if you kind of zoom in on the step function that happens when you tune successively to different frequencies, we have these different characteristics of the information that we're getting over time from the airwaves. And one of those is the instantaneous bandwidth. How wide a bandwidth are we analyzing at each hop in frequency? And that is a function only of the sample rate of the software-defined radio platform. So in the case of a Realtek dongle, you can get about 2.5 million samples per second. So that gives you 2 megahertz of bandwidth or so. With HackRF, we can get 10 times that much bandwidth. We can do 20 million samples per second. So we can look at 20 megahertz of bandwidth in one hop. And then another thing that affects our ability to do this stuff is the tuning time. How long does it take to tune to change the frequency from one channel to another? It takes some finite amount of time to do that. And during that time, we're not capturing any information. But the faster we can do that, the more we can reduce that tuning time, then the more overall hops per second we can get. And also, another thing to consider is the capture time. How many samples are we capturing? Well, you probably want to capture at least one, probably more than one, maybe 1,000 or something like that, maybe several thousand. And the ratio there, or the capture tuning time compared to, sorry, the capture time compared to the tuning time tells us, you know, what kind of duty cycle we get how much of the time are we actually capturing information? And one thing I've tried to suggest by having these sort of horizontally elongated bricks up there is that if we have a lot of instantaneous bandwidth, maybe we can trade off some duty cycle. Maybe it's okay to have a relatively short capture time in comparison to the tuning time. But if we wanted to optimize this and get as much information as we possibly can out of the software-defined radio platform, the one thing that we really need to focus on is the tuning time. How long does it take to tune from one channel to another? And in the case of the tools that I've shown you so far, that is, unfortunately, a control that's happening on the host computer over USB. And then the USB device retunes, and that takes some amount of time. And then we start getting data over USB again. And that round trip time on the USB actually severely limits how fast we can tune. So this is something I've been working on with HackRF, because we can use the microcontroller in the HackRF to actually tune to step through different frequencies and not have to have that controlled over USB. And I haven't really fully optimized this yet, but I've been experimenting with it, and I found that kind of my worst case tuning time is about 750 microseconds. My best case tuning time is under 150 microseconds. And so I'm trying to figure out if I can reduce my worst case down to around much closer to my best case. Either way, I'm well under a millisecond of tuning time, which means I can get 1,000 plus hops per second. And in the RTL power software I was using, for example, that I did overnight, that was only doing one hop per second. What if we can get thousands of hops per second? We can get so much more information out of our software-defined radio devices. And for example, you might want to think about how much information you're getting. You might want to multiply your instantaneous bandwidth by your hops per second. I can get 1,000 plus with HackRF if I control it on the CPU that is on the HackRF. I don't know actually what the limit is with controlling it over USB, but I've heard that people have gotten the Realtek dongles to go to like 40-ish hops per second. So 40 hops per second times 2.5 megahertz versus 1,000 hops per second times 20 megahertz. It's a really big difference. A couple orders of magnitude difference in how much information you get out of your SDR equipment. So that's what I'm working on right now, and I hope that later on this year I'll be able to publish some of that work. It's something that I hope people here will be interested to experiment with. Thanks for coming. I'm Mike from Gray Scott Gadgets, and I do have a HackRF demo set up over at the TAPR booth also, so come by sometime over the weekend, see the Whitebox, see HackRF, see a whole bunch of cool stuff over at the TAPR booth. Do we have time for one question?
I just wondered, did you consider using two devices and ping-ponging to get away from your tuning time?
Oh, that's a good question. Have I considered two devices and ping-ponging between them to solve the tuning time problem? Yes, I haven't played with that myself, but I know other people have. And one or more of the tools that I mentioned actually supports that already. So you can have, theoretically, you can have an arbitrary number of devices that are all tuned to different frequencies at different times. And that's a great way to get more information and less skipping of stuff that's happening over the air. Thank you all very much.
So much technology, so little time. Well, tell you what, we've got more time coming up in October. Two and a half days worth at the Digital Communications Conference. So if you're interested in seeing that, then I need to send you over to my Kickstarter site. And nothing's been pledged yet. Wait a minute. Let me refresh. I'm not sure that updates. Nope. Nothing has been pledged yet. So you got your chance. So this is Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, SKN4AQ. We'll see you in October. And we'll see you on the next program, but we'll see you in October for the DCC in Chicago. I don't know what I'm talking about. Over and out.